special guest here today, the curator of this exhibition, Modigliani and the Wonder of Portugal. Dr. Kenneth Wayne founded the Modigliani Project in 2013 to research and chronicle the art and life of Amadeo Modigliani. The aim is to promote scholarship and secure the artist's legacy for posterity. An established art historian, curator, and museum professional, Dr. Wayne has studied Modigliani for more than 30 years and leads the Modigliani Project's activities as president. He oversees research and scholarship projects, the advisory council's activities, and the catalog resume committee's work. Dr. Wayne holds a PhD from Stanford University, an MA in Modern Art from the Courtauld Institute of Art, University of London, and a BA in Art History from the University of California at Berkeley. He also studied art law at Stanford University Law School. During his career, Dr. Wayne has curated dozens of exhibitions on late 19th and early 20th century art. He has served as deputy director of the Noguchi Museum, chief curator of Heckscher Museum of Art, curator of modern art at Albright Knox Art Gallery, and the Jason Whitney Payson curator at Portland Museum of Art in Maine. Please welcome Dr. Kenneth Wayne.
Thank you very much. Thank you for coming. I hope you enjoyed the exhibition. Italian restaurants. So if they weren't Chinese restaurants or Mexican restaurants, they were very devoted to their own culture. I'm not saying that's bad, because obviously Italian food is good, and their culture and background, but it just gives it a flavor of the town that he grew up in. Just above Livorno is Carrara, the Carrara marble quarry, which is where Michelangelo got his marble for his big sculpture, his famous sculpture of David, which is in the Accademia of Florence. So that's also important, because I think Michelangelo was definitely an inspiration to him throughout his life. They were both painters, sculptors, and poets. And so I think even though he didn't write about it or talk about it, it's pretty obvious that Michelangelo was an important person in his life. Livorno is west of Florence. So it's Tuscany, and so that's an important thing to consider as well. I'll show you some postcards of Livorno. So it is a town with canals, which likens it to Venice, and in fact, the city planning was based on Venice's city planning. And so there were waterways. And it was a fishing port, seaport. It has a very rich and interesting history. In Livorno, when you visit, there are a couple places where the Modigliani family lived. And there's a plaque on one that talks about Modigliani. And the other house, it doesn't mention Modigliani. Amedeo Modigliani mentions his brother, Giuseppe Emanuele, who was famous in his own right. He was the head of the Socialist Party, and therefore automatically an enemy of Mussolini. And that affected his posthumous history. So because Mussolini tried to erase the name Modigliani from Italian history. And so during that crucial period when he was in power, the government didn't acquire any of Amadeo's works for its museums. So that's an unfortunate reality, is that Italian museums are actually very weak in the work of Amadeo Modigliani. The United States is much stronger, France is much stronger, so if you wonder why you don't see Modigliani when you go to Italy, you'll know why now. So yeah, Giuseppe Emanuele, he lived a long time, and he published a lot, he wrote books, so for many people when you mention the name Modigliani in Italy, he's the first one they think of, not the other. Those of us in the art field, obviously it's a different situation. This was his birthplace in Livorno. There's a plaque on the wall there to signify that. It actually doesn't, when I visited, it didn't look so dumpy. So I guess it had been renovated and patched up. I got there. But I was able to enter, and it was a spacious apartment, and the views in the back are over a garden, and a beautiful garden with palm trees, actually. And so, very nice place. Here's an 18th century view of Livorno Synagogue, which was the second largest in Europe after Amsterdam. So it was larger than the synagogue in Rome. But it was destroyed during World War II. You can see it was mostly made of wood. This is the exact synagogue where Modigliani had his bar mitzvah. And so the rabbi at the time, who's quite famous, is the Elia Ben Zalmodic. I'm sure I garbled that, but Ben was a, well, whatever I said first. So in any case, very important figure in Livorno's history and Jewish history. He was an expert on the Kabbalah, so the Jewish mystical texts, so which Modigliani was certainly aware of, and he even makes references to it a couple times on his drawings. So that was another part of his formation and background was this Jewish text. Livorno had the second biggest community in Italy after Rome. That's why you would think it would have the second biggest synagogue after Rome, but in fact it had a larger one. The Medici family invited Jews who moved to Livorno from Spain after the Inquisition and turned it into a free port where Jews had extensive privileges and freedoms. So unlike most Italian cities of a certain size, Livorno did not have a ghetto where Jews were required to live. Livorno was, also as I mentioned, important for the Kabbalah and for this rabbi. One thing to mention about this rabbi is that a book just came out all about his life, so within the last two years. So I have that on my desk, waiting to be read. So.
Can you spell the last name of the rabbi?
Yes, okay, let me find. B-E-N A-M O-Z E-G-H. So I want to read about him and see what kind of ideas he planted in Modigliani's head that helped him develop into the arts that he became. One last comment on Modigliani and his Jewish background. In Spain, his family had lived in Seville in the south, and the family name was Levi. After the Inquisition, the family moved to Italy, specifically to a small town named Modigliana. And they adopted the town's name as their family name. This was a Jewish custom. So that's kind of the longer and fuller history of his background. So then, so he did a grand tour in Italy. He went to Naples, he went to Rome with his mother, learned all about Italian history and art history. And then he moved to Venice, where he met a fellow artist who told him Paris is the place to be. And so in 1906, he went to Paris and quickly gravitated. I'm having a problem here with that. So he went to Paris, and that's where his career really unfolded. So he lived there from 1906 until January 1920, and that's where he died. He went home, I think, a couple times back to Livorno. Okay. So Paris, so he gravitated quickly towards Montparnasse, in the artist area, very important to many artists. There's a place there, Carrefour Bavin, the Bavin intersection. And there, like 100 different famous artists lived within 100 yards of Carrefour Bavin. Modigliani, Picasso, Diego Rivera, Mondrian. So it was, and it still exists today. People still live and work there. One of my favorite restaurants actually is called the Bistro du Dome, so it's right behind the Cafe du Dome. And so this was a very important area for the history of art, because the cafes were like their offices. So they could get phone calls there, you know, so phone calls would come in and be written down and pinned to a board. Same with mail, so they received mail there, it was pinned to a board. And they also met dealers and clients there for commissions and contacts and exhibiting. So that was key. In this one photo on the bottom right, that's Modigliani next to the art critic / art dealer Adolf Basler. So yes, Montparnasse, and Duchamp called it the first really international group of artists we ever had. And so in this drawing, we have the Mexican, Diego Rivera, the Italian Modigliani, and Russian poet Ilya Ehrenberg. So that was really the incubator for what we call modern art. But at the time, it was called international art, because it had these influences from so many different cultures. And that's what helped create it. So you don't necessarily see aspects of Spanish art or Mexican art, but you see things that are kind of universal to different cultures. A lot of geometric figures, abstract paintings, and colors that, you know, the primary colors, in all these different artists' work. So even like, so someone like Montparnasse, who's right there, and Modigliani, they don't immediately look like they're connected. But in fact, if you drill down, there are certain concepts that are similar to both. So one very powerful influence on Modigliani was African art. And so he borrowed certain visual features, which as